I suggest to get started. So welcome everybody. Like in order not to kind of keep you waiting, so people who manage to get here in time, it's I think a waste to wait for the people who don't manage to get here in time. And indeed, like the first thing to say is that actually Sophie and I swapped. So this morning we are going to talk about kind of the afternoon program, which is about connectivity. So I'm going to start with a lecture about connectivity, and then the hands-on session will be obviously also about connectivity. And in the afternoon, Sophie will take over and do a lecture on beamforming and the hands-on about beamforming. And that's not a big problem. I mean, like, the thing is, like, these topics are related, obviously, but they are not so tightly connected that didactically it makes a difference which order it's going to be presented. Let me first introduce myself. My name is Jan-Matthijs Schoffler. I haven't done so properly this week. Sorry about that, but well, I take the opportunity now. So I'm an associate PI these days. Well, these days I'm an associate PI because the directorate has decided that I can call myself an associate PI, which basically means that I'm kind of something which is a bit more than a postdoc. And I'm running my own research program here at the DCCN, which is concerned with systems neuroscience type of questions, interested in like how do kind of brain regions interact in all types of different cognitive domains and also in like perceptual systems. And I'm particularly interested in studying connectivity between brain regions. And that's going to be the topic of today. But before starting, like really kicking off, I'm just going to make a bit of an advertisement also leading up to today's topic. And apart from being a scientist, I also sing in a choir. So people who are around, like for a bit longer in this toolkit, or people who are from Nijmegen and the surroundings, they are all kindly invited to come to our concert next Sunday. And the reason why I do this is basically like we are obviously a very good choir and we sing very nice music. We also need the money, so people please come. But also the topic of the concert actually has quite some links to what I'm going to talk about today. And quite coincidentally, there are a few pieces on the program which are even more linked to the overall content of this toolkit, because there are two pieces which are called Sleep in this concert. So you're kindly invited. It's Sunday at 3:30. If you cannot make it, you have an opportunity to come the week afterwards on the 22nd of April. So please do come. And why do I mention all this? Well, this is about a choir. And a choir is actually a good kind of analogy or a good example or like an analogy to what the brain is doing. So today we're going to talk about connectivity. Connectivity is an interesting topic. My talk is going to be a bit on the technical side, so I'm not going to talk in much detail about why it would be interesting to study connectivity to begin with. So I assume that you all kind of have some basic idea about, well, why we would want to learn about this. And to give an example, I mean, I think like a good functioning choir, a brain needs to be connected, obviously, in order to be able to function. So in a choir, there are different singers, and in order to kind of make good music, what we need to do is we need to connect. We need to synchronize in one way, right? I mean, we need to kind of be at the same time, sing the same notes, and the different voices need to somehow sing the same notes in a certain relationship with respect to one another. And only then it works, right? Only then we are able to make good music. And in some way, that's very similar to what's happening in the brain, right? Like we have these functionally specialized areas which all have particular roles to play in cognition and perception and what have you, behavior. And obviously, in order to really kind of work properly, all these regions need to interact and need to connect and need to operate in a certain well-coordinated way. Well, another analogy with a choir would be that if we are listening to a choir singing, what we hear is kind of music. It's kind of a combination of individual signals produced by individual nodes, the individual singers in the choir. In analogy to neuroimaging data, or particularly electrophysiological data, we have individual channels which contain time series which we are listening to, we are recording the signals. And in order to investigate how they connect, the product of how they interact with each other is basically more than the sum of the parts, let's say. So the way they connect, like in order to kind of come up with a percept of what these voices in a choir or what these signals that we are recording are doing together, we need to analyze these signals also together. So not only looking at a single channel, not only analyzing the time series that we observed at a single channel, as we have been doing for the past 2 days when we were doing event-related fields, which basically means we take a channel and we do some processing on the time series that has been recorded on that channel, or when we were processing the signals in terms of their oscillations. Now we are going to think about combining what we are observing at different channels, combining what we are listening to different singers, and then we, based on how we combine it, we make an inference or we make an interpretation of what these individual notes are doing together. So as I already started out with, so I have this pointer which actually doesn't work because like it doesn't point at the screen. Doesn't it work actually? Yes, it does, but it doesn't work here. So I'm occasionally pointing, but so just kind of guess where I'm pointing at. So I started out with Niet saying that like the past 2 days we have been like looking at signals from a single signal point of view, where we have been looking at characteristics that can be extracted from the time series. For example, looking at like components, event-related components, by means of averaging the signals. We were looking at spectral characteristics, so the power spectra or the kind of the like time frequency characteristics, where we are like both analyzing the signal in terms of time and of frequency. The lower part of the slide, that's indeed like actually included, that's already alluding to what we're going to talk about in detail this afternoon. So like if we have individual signals, we can also look at spatial characteristics. Well, in that sense, it's not really about individual signals, but then it's about if we have a collection of signals, we can actually interpret topographies of particular components that are observed simultaneously at many channels at once. So then we are talking about source reconstruction techniques or blind source separation techniques such as PCA and ICA. So that's kind of what we are going, what by the end of the day we have talked about. And then by the end of the day we also have talked about is about something which is called bivariate analysis. But first I'm going to show what's like as a take-home message, the signal characteristics we have been talking about, ERPs, spectral components, TFRs, they all reflect univariate signal properties. So essentially, we have a bunch of channels, we are recording signals from them, and we are analyzing, we are applying an analysis algorithm, black box operation, if you will, to each of those signals separately in order to extract a particular characteristics, and then from that signal, looping over all these signals, and then later on we're going to do a statistical test that we are going to talk about tomorrow, for example. We can do ERPs, we can do TFRs, but what we're going to talk about today is about connectivity analysis this morning, and we are going to go beyond univariate analysis. So what I kind of tried to already allude to in my introduction with the choir, so rather than just looking at a single channel at a time and repeating that particular procedure many times for each of the channels, now we're going to combine information across time series, again using some mathematical algorithms that we think is a meaningful algorithm to compute a relationship between these signals, and talk about and interpret that as connectivity. So the idea would indeed be that in this cartoon we are measuring activity from the brain, so in this case we happen also to measure activity from a muscle by means of an EMG, and we are using, to start simply, we are using the signals themselves as if they are representations of the activity of sources directly underlying that part of the directly underlying these sensors, so representing activity coming from a particular part of the brain, or representing activity that is coming from the spinal cord in the case of the EMG. And then we are going to apply some signal processing techniques where we are going to link or relate the signals that we have recorded at these different locations, and we are going to infer that if there is a meaningful relationship as observed by linking these two signals, that the underlying brain regions or the underlying neuronal pools are connected or interacting in a meaningful way. And like when we think about it, like when we are facing the possibility of linking signals that we have measured at multiple locations with each other, we already have the kind of the challenge to decide out of like tens or like hundreds of different types of connectivity metrics. And in order to kind of make a bit of sense out of this whole realm of connectivity measures, people have tried to come up with different taxonomies, like divide the different types of connectivity metrics along different dimensions. And one of the kind of classical ones is a distinction between functional, effective, and then also structural connectivity, which was made by Friston already 15 years ago or so. And basically, functional connectivity means nothing else that there is a statistical relationship between pairs of signals. Nothing more, nothing less. So it's kind of a correlation type of interaction or a correlation type of relationship, which in itself is an interesting property, but it does not really tell you whether there is truly some kind of causal interaction between the brain areas involved. And that's denoted by the term of effective connectivity. So there are connectivity measures which try and quantify the relationship between signals, going beyond a correlative or statistical relationship, but trying to really infer whether region A is driving the activity in region B, for example. So that's denoted with the term effective connectivity. So another dimension among which kind of these measures can be divided is whether they are based on kind of explicit model assumptions or whether they are extracted purely by a data-driven way. So like in a data-driven way, with that I mean that you just apply some analysis algorithm to your signals, and then all of a sudden a number pops up, and this number that you take as the connectivity measure, as opposed to a model-based approach where you explicitly build a, let's say, connectionist model of the nodes in your recording setup, and then you explicitly say, well, I think that node A is connected with node B, and that B is receiving input for A, for example. So that's more in the context of what is like the most famous example of that model-based approach is DCM, so dynamic causal modeling, where you explicitly have to build a priori several models of your kind of possible connectionist interactions between your regions, and you're going to test in your data which of those models are the most plausible, is the most plausible. Another dimension among which these connectivity measures can be divided is whether you are defining your measure or analyzing your signals in the time domain or in the frequency domain. So that's kind of related to what we have discussed yesterday, right? ERPs versus spectral methods. And there is kind of this mathematical dimension where one could interpret the connectivity measure as it is either derived using linear techniques, linear mathematical techniques, or nonlinear measures. That detail is not too important for now. But what is important for now is that for the remainder of this talk, which again is going to be a bit technical, I'm going to focus on explaining first a bit in detail about connectivity measures that are data-driven, predominantly reflect functional connectivity. They are linear measures and they are in the frequency domain. And in the frequency domain, if we talk about interactions, then we often think about the concept of synchrony. And I make a small excursion to model-based connectivity measures. One second. To model-based connectivity measures, where I'm going to actually go beyond the pure synchrony and coherence measure, and I'm going to talk about Granger causality a bit. Wim. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So structural connectivity. That's actually basically the anatomical backbone on which all the connectivity can occur. So the idea is like structural connectivity basically means like which regions are connected by means of large white matter kind of tracts, or what's the, let's say, local connections by means of local axonal and dendritic interactions. And well, I mean, like, it's a good question. So it, like, the idea would be like structural connectivity is almost is always there, right? I mean, that's just a given. So it might very slowly change over the course of development, for example, or it might be disrupted due to kind of diseases or clinical conditions. But the idea, of course, is that like the brain is very dynamic. So over like within a cognitive context, connection profiles can very rapidly change. So even though the structural connections are always there, the interesting question is how does it work that in some situations region A is really influencing region B in relation to other situations? Because, well, I mean, depends highly on the context which regions have to flexibly interact in order to, well, perform a certain task. So this is my Muppet slide, and this Muppet slide is actually intended to just show to you that there are many, many different measures of connectivity, even if we only talk about connectivity measures defined in a frequency domain. And it might appear a bit bewildering if you're not familiar with the terminology, but my take-home message, I hope, after this presentation is that actually many of these connectivity measures reflect similar things, and the black box operations that are needed in order to extract these quantities, they are very similar with respect to one another, and the individual measures, they only focus on slightly different aspects of the signals. So just to give you an impression of which kind of phase synchrony or frequency domain measures there are, there's just a bunch of them, so about, what is it, 10 or so. And what I'm going to talk about is, I'm pointing next to the screen now, right? So the coherence coefficient, or the left upper corner, because I think that's a very basic quantity, which is, I think, interesting to know a bit about. And in order to do so, I'm going to recapitulate a bit what Mats has been talking about on Monday, and that's related to the question, so what denotes an oscillation? So if we are talking about coherence, we are talking about an interaction that is synchronization, and if we talk about synchronization, or more specifically, if we talk about oscillatory synchronization, we are talking about oscillations, obviously. So if we consider a signal, you've seen this slide, right? Or not, yeah. If we consider a signal, the signal is just a wiggly line, so it's an amplitude value defined at many time points, consecutive time points, and in this case it's going up and down, and there is some periodicity in it, so it's moving up and down in a more or less regular way. So we can define different quantities then, or we can estimate different quantities from such signals, and the first one is the period, which is basically the stretch of time between two peaks or two troughs of the signal, and if that's more or less regular, we can talk about an oscillation, where this oscillation has a particular frequency, which is one divided by the period. We can also extract from these lines something which is called an amplitude envelope, right? So how is the waxing and waning, how far from the zero line is it as a function of time? So that typically occurs dynamically. And we can talk about something that is the phase. And like so far, like until yesterday, we have mainly looked at amplitude and power of signals, right? So we have done a time frequency decomposition where essentially, as a function of frequency and time, we are quantifying from a signal how strong the amplitude squared is. If we are going to talk about synchronization, we also have to be concerned about the phase. And the phase, it's, well, you might have kind of some intuitive idea about it, and that's good enough. If you don't, I'm going to give it now. It's a circular quantity which tells you how far the signal is from a reference point. So let's say if we take the trough as a reference point, where we say the trough is zero phase, then if you have an oscillation, it's rotating 360 degrees back to zero, and if it's back to zero or at 360, then the signal is back at the trough. Yeah, so that's what phase means. And the idea is, why would it be interesting to talk about phase in general, or to talk about synchronization? Well, essentially, synchronization means that if you have two signals that they are, which are oscillating, if they are oscillating at the same frequency, if they are synchronized, it means that there is a fixed phase relationship between the oscillations. Yeah, so if they are perfectly in sync, they go up and down together. If they are out of sync, they are in sync, but they are at antiphase, then one goes up and the other one goes down, and any relationship in between can exist. And like there are mechanistic hypotheses, and one influential mechanistic hypothesis in the field of neuroscience is kind of the so-called communication through coherence hypothesis. So you might have heard about it. Is the idea that synchronization between neural groups is actually a mechanistic principle through which these neuronal groups can interact with each other. So the idea would be that if we see synchronization, which means that the oscillations are going up and down in a tight relationship with one another, information that is sent back and forth between these two neuronal groups can have a much more efficient impact on one another. Where the idea would be that if a barrage of action potentials is hitting a receiving neuronal group when the oscillation is close to spiking threshold itself, then this barrage of action potentials is much more efficient in eliciting a response of in the receiving group of neurons. Right? So this is kind of a physiological mechanistic idea through which basically motivates using synchronization type of measures as a relevant quantity to probe interactions between neural areas. Yeah, why? Well, one side remark to make there is that if we are now talking about synchronization and coherence, are we then really looking at interaction or information exchange? Well, probably not. We might be looking at the preconditions which allow efficient information exchange, but of course the information exchange in the end of the day is by means of the action potentials. But it's actually a similar discussion when we are talking about alpha oscillations or beta oscillations. Are they reflecting information processing or do they reflect activation of brain areas? I mean, that's kind of an ever recurring discussion which we always have to keep in the back of our minds when we are interpreting our results. Okay, so this was a side path. Let's get back to our oscillations and our phase discussion. And just to kind of give you an idea what an oscillation can be, what it looks like, and just give a different representation, which is introducing the way I'm going to represent the signals later on. Again, I'm going to show an oscillation in a little movie, where on the left I show the normal time series, and now if I start the movie, time is going to evolve, so the signal is going to play. And on the right, I'm representing the same oscillation, but now in a polar representation. So rather than having time on a linear axis, I basically have time on a circular axis. So time is now going to evolve in a circular axis. And what you see is that there is a little vector which is going to rotate over time. If the movie works, well, if it worked yesterday, it works today as well. That's good. And this circular representation of an oscillation is a very compact way to talk about oscillation. So rather that you have to kind of draw as a function of time your oscillation, you can just draw it in a circle with a at any point in time as a little line connected from the origin to a point on the circle where the length of that line reflects the amplitude of the oscillation at that moment in time. And the angle that line is making with respect to the positive x-axis reflects the phase, right? So if it makes one rotation, then one cycle of the oscillation has occurred. And we can then give a mathematical notation to that polar representation of an oscillation, where it's a complex exponential, so some of you might be familiar with that. Don't get afraid if you're not familiar with it, because I'm just talking you through it. So it's complex exponential, so it's e to the power of I times something, and this times something is the phase of the oscillation. And the A term, which is kind of an amplitude term, which is not in the exponent, but it's just in front of the complex exponential, reflects the amplitude. And this is a compact way in which a Fourier transform can be represented, where for a given frequency, there is a phase and an amplitude. Yeah, and the mathematics, so you can, this is just a mathematical representation which is very convenient in order to manipulate. So if you're now going to talk about synchrony and interactions, I'm going to use this notation more often. So as I said now, rather than looking at univariate signal properties, synchrony or connectivity is about looking at bivariate or multivariate signal properties. So if we are going to talk about multiple signals, I'm going to show you, play you a movie of two signals developing over time. And what you see now on the upper and the lower circle, you see two oscillations which are rotating, and now these oscillations are a bit more rich in features as compared to this very simple sine wave I showed in the previous slide. The circles, they are, well, in this case, amplitude normalized oscillations. So the only thing that you see is that the phase is rotating over time. And in the middle, what I show, for each time point, rather than showing the phase of one of the signals, I'm showing the phase difference. So how is the phase of signal A at each time point related to the phase of signal B at each time point? And if I play the movie again, what you will see in these two signals, also you can see it on the left, so the time courses, they are relatively different, right? So in this case, these signals are not, don't seem to be connected at all. If I play it again, you see that the phase difference over time is going all over the place. So it's describing many different phase differences along this unit circle. So this essentially reflects the fact that because the phase difference over time is scattered, there is low synchrony between the two signals. Yeah, and this is in contrast to a situation where there is high synchrony. So in these two signals, they look much more similar. They are not the same, right? But they look more similar than in the previous example. If I now play the movie, what you see is that although the phase difference over time is still not super constant, it's now much more constrained to a certain part of this polar representation. So that means that the phase difference over time is much more concentrated around a certain value, and then you can say there is high synchrony. And many of the synchronization measures, which I showed in this Muppet Show slide, they intend to quantify in some way how consistent the phase difference is over time. And the most classic example of how that can be quantified is a so-called coherence coefficient. And that is computed, as with most other synchrony measures, from the complex from the Fourier representation of a signal, from the frequency domain representation of a signal. And remember, each of the signals can be represented by means of a complex exponential with a phase and an amplitude. And in order to compute coherence, we are going to combine these numbers. And combining these numbers is done for coherence by computing something that is called the cross-fractal density between two signals. And that is obtained by a mathematical operation that's called conjugate multiplication of the frequency domain representation of the signals. So this is in words. How does it look in mathematical symbols? So we take signal x and signal x2, frequency domain representation. We take the conjugate of the second one, and the conjugate basically means that we are taking the negative of the phase exponent of the complex value, right, that you see here. And then we do the multiplication. And this is just kind of simple mathematical operations on these numbers. So we are allowed to, we can just multiply the amplitude terms. And if you are multiplying two exponential quantities with each other, what you need to do is you have to add up the exponents. If we're adding up the exponent while we have taken the negative of the second exponent, we are essentially computing the difference of the phase. Yeah, so here we get, in a mathematical operation, for a given pair of signal, an estimate of how the phases are related to each other, how they are different. Yeah, and if we now observe our signal many times, many time points, or many trials, what we get is we get many estimates of these cross-spectral densities. And these cross-spectral densities are complex-valued numbers. Again, they can be represented as polar in a polar representation, so something which has an amplitude and an angle. And the idea now is, if we now observe it many times, and if the angle of the difference is more or less pointing into the same direction each time we are observing it, we say there is high synchrony. So if we average these, if we sum these little vectors, they are all pointing in the same direction, so they add up very efficiently, as compared to a situation where each of these individual arrows is pointing in random directions, so they don't add up very efficiently. We have high synchrony, we have low synchrony. And coherence is computed by just averaging these guys, these complex-valued cross-spectral density vectors over observations, normalizing them, and then you get a value. And this value is always bounded between 0 and 1.
How do you disassociate between these two signals perform the same?
That's a good question. So let me repeat it for the audience looking on YouTube. So the question is, can you dissociate, if you compute coherence, can you distinguish between synchrony, as in are the two signals that you are assuming to be separate neuronal sources, does this synchrony value really reflect an interaction, or does it reflect just the fact that you are measuring the same underlying single source from those two signals? That's the question, right? I'm getting back to that later in the presentation, so stay tuned. But that's a very difficult question, and that's really relevant always to keep in mind when you're interpreting your signal. So sometimes you can, sometimes you cannot, and I'm going to explain it later. Yeah, go ahead. No, so the question is, what's the difference between a Rayleigh test? So a Rayleigh test is a circular statistical test which evaluates whether there is kind of a optimal phase distribution in a phase, which is kind of, let's say, a circular Gaussian estimation type of test. The difference is, in the end of the day, probably not much. It's just based on a slightly different philosophy, and the Rayleigh test in itself already also tries to kind of extract, let's say, a p-value, right? So how likely is it that when I'm observing a distribution of phase differences, that it's obtained from a distribution that is deviating from a flat distribution? That's what the Rayleigh test is actually doing. In some way, coherence does not the coherence value itself does not give you this information, because you always get a coherence value. You can always apply your black box operation, and it tells you there will be a non-zero coherence coefficient just by means of your black box operation. And like, if you have coherence, then you need, in the next step, indeed ask yourself, well, is this value I have now extracted, is that a meaningful value? And then we enter the discussion of like doing statistics, indeed. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's exactly the idea. So the no. So sorry, I was not explicit in it. So the length of the arrow. So this is kind of an averaging operation in this case. Well, strictly speaking, coherence is a summation of these cross spectral densities and then normalizing it with the power of the signals. Then you get first you get a complex valued quantity which has a length and the phase. The length itself tells you the coherence coefficient, so that's but there is also phase information which tells you, let's say, the angle at which the signals are on average the phase difference on average between the two signals. But the classical coherence, it's only about the length, but there will be some more detail later. Yeah. Yeah, well, okay, so I'm going to talk about it. Okay, so the thing is, indeed, and but I'm just going to prelude a bit on it. So complex valued numbers, amplitudes, phases, right? So it's a particular representation of this arrow. So you can describe an arrow in the complex plane by a vector which has a particular length and a phase. But you can also describe it as a real and an imaginary part. So then basically what you are doing is you are taking this point, so the tip of the arrow, and you take the x-coordinate and the y-coordinate of that arrow. Yeah, and the x-coordinate is something we call the real valued part, and the y-coordinate is something we call the imaginary valued part. And that's then exactly related to the question you asked, that everything which is pointing away from the real valued axis essentially reflects synchrony or consistent phase differences which are different from zero, because if it's kind of pointing along the x-axis, then the phase difference is zero, and phase and interactions that are pointing away from 180 degrees, that's kind of phase differences which are on the negative x-axis, and phase differences that are at zero or at 180 degrees, they are suspicious. They can be suspicious in their interpretation because they could reflect the fact that the signals you are measuring are picking up the same underlying source, because the same underlying source instantaneously projects the activity to multiple channels. If you then combine measurements at these two channels into a synchrony measure and you get a phase difference of zero, you can never explicitly tell whether or not this is due to a single source which is basically projecting activity, or whether there are two separate neuronal sources which are doing something at zero time lag, which is the interesting story, of course, you want to tell, but you also want to avoid making wrong conclusions. So that has to do with imaginary coherence. So one sec. So if you now apply a mathematical trick and only, rather than looking at the length of this arrow, only look at the projection of this arrow onto the y-axis, which is essentially is taking the imaginary part of this coherency value, then what you get can never be explained by common sources. So like if you get a significant non-zero value in your imaginary part of the coherency, then people tend to interpret that quantity as reflecting a true interaction of underlying sources. So now I already gave it away, so I can skip my last slide. So that's thanks for that. Yeah, next slide. Now, I think. Yes. So the normalization indeed. So what you get if you do the coherence coefficient. So here on top, I see there is a summation sign. So you're summating the individual observations of the cross spectral density, you know, normalizing it. So you take the average, so it's basically the normalization. So the idea is the summation works because it's a complex valued summation. So you basically put all the arrows end to tail and only then divide it by their length, which is different from only taking the length and averaging it. So I leave you to think about that for yourselves. And then you're normalizing it with the square root of the product of the power. And the power is essentially the cross-spectral density of a signal with respect to each other. Because if you take a signal with respect to each other and you take the cross-spectral density, the phase phi 1 and then phi 2, like phi 1 minus phi 2 is zero. So I mean, it's a zero phase difference. So that drops out of the equation, and then you are basically multiplying the power estimates of the two signals, and that's your normalization term. And essentially, this is why I indeed include this formula here, not to show that I am so good at math, but to basically give you like the impression that another very popular measure, which is called the phase locking value, which has been around for, let's say, 15 years or so, it is computed in very similar machinery. So again, it is an absolute value, so that's equivalent to taking the length of the arrow, that's what I haven't said yet. It's taking, in the numerator, it's taking an average of complex valued phase differences, but rather than taking the amplitudes with them, it's normalizing by the amplitude, so it's basically discarding the amplitude information. And actually, this formula looks very much, if you're familiar with kind of correlations, like the formula for a correlation. Because correlation is also, if you take two signals, now in the time domain, what you do is you compute a pointwise product. So you take the average of the pointwise products, which is essentially the covariance between two signals, and you normalize it with the product of the variances. That's just a simple Pearson correlation. So long story short, so I could have discarded all these previous slides with complex valued exponentials and so on and so forth by saying that coherence essentially is not much different from a correlation coefficient in the frequency domain. So this is already kind of preluding to the question you ask about imaginary coherence. So like as I already showed, coherence itself is an absolute value. It's the length of this arrow. There is also phase information, and if we don't take the length of the arrow, but we keep the coherence C as a complex valued quantity, we call it coherency. And then there is indeed an amplitude term, which is the traditional coherence coefficient, and there is a phase difference term, which gives us information, at least if there is significant non-zero coherence at a particular frequency, about the phase relationship between the signals at on average. And indeed, if you represent this complex valued quantity in a different way, so in terms of their imaginary and their real valued part, then indeed, like, let's say 10 years ago, somebody basically said, well, rather than looking at the coherence coefficient, it's probably better to look at the imaginary part only if we really want to interpret this measure of interaction in terms of true interactions. I'm getting back to that in slightly more detail. For the interest of time, I'm going to skip this a bit. So long story short, there is indeed additional information in the coherency coefficient, if you take the phase difference into account, where the optimal phase difference also gives you an indication of the time delay between the two signals. And in that sense, it makes already the coherence coefficient slightly different from what I said, the correlation coefficient, because correlation itself, it's a symmetric quantity, so you don't know, well, I mean, A to B and B to A, it's the same correlation. For coherence, it's the same thing, but if you can estimate a delay, you know which one of the signals is leading the other one. And if there is a temporal delay where signal A is leading signal B, one could, let's say, infer that signal A is causing is having an effect on signal B, right? So it's more than a symmetric one-to-one relationship. Wim?
I do not completely understand the imaginary versus the real coherence. What's imaginary about it? What makes the y-axis imaginary and not the x-axis imaginary?
Yeah, that's a mathematical definition, but is it okay if I postpone this until I get there? Because otherwise we end up talking for the whole morning, which I like, because I like to kind of talk about this, but there's more we have to do, and then it's more in context. Okay, so I mentioned coherence coefficient is the frequency domain analog of the cross-correlation coefficient. In that sense, one could, these are just a few statements I'm just throwing at you, just to give you an idea that there is nothing magical about coherence. So in that sense, like a Pearson correlation coefficient R square type of quantities, they essentially in a GLM framework or a regression framework, they basically reflect the amount of variance explained, right, in a regression model. So that basically means in the context of connectivity, how much of the variance at a particular frequency in signal A can be explained by information of the oscillations at the same frequency in signal B. So in some way, coherence can be thought of as a frequency domain analog of a linear regression. Obviously, and that's the same with correlations versus regressions, there is a conceptual difference because independent and dependent variables can be exchanged. And this is what I very briefly alluded to. If we look at the slope, so there is information, the slope of the relative phase spectrum, and then we have to think of coherence or phase differences as a function of frequency. So what I have been talking about with these circular representations, I've been always implicitly computing the coherence for a frequency in Fourier spectrum, but like obviously the black box operation is done for each of the frequencies in the spectrum. So what you end up with is with a coherence value as a function of frequency. You get a spectrum in a very similar way as what you get when you get a power spectrum. And you can also get a phase difference spectrum. And if there is a linear portion in the phase difference spectrum which has a particular slope, which has a kind of slope that can be well fitted, this slope reflects a time delay between the signals. The problem is, however, that this slope is often hard to estimate or often zero. So this coherence quantity and the trick here cannot often be reliably used in order to infer causal interactions between signals. So that's why we need different quantities to estimate this. And now we are going back to the future a bit, because now we're going to move to kind of a quantity which can indeed infer causal interactions also in the frequency domain in terms of synchronization, and that has to do with linear prediction and Granger causality. Yes. Yes, that is related also to the question that was asked earlier, indeed. Can I postpone this to later? Yes, okay. So we're going back to the future a bit. So this is where we can breathe a bit, because it's intentionally I occasionally include these kind of nice figures. Do you still know this movie or not? I mean, like, I'm getting older and older, but I mean, okay, anyway. linear prediction. So what, like, how can we kind of infer causal relationships between signals? So I'm going back to the time domain for the time being, because it's easier explained in time domain, the concept of Granger causality. So Granger causality, it's derived from econometrics, which also deals with time series, obviously. And the idea is here that if we have a time series of something, some people at some point ask themselves the question, can I predict upcoming values of my time series based on the past of that same time series? And people started kind of developing models for that. So these are called autoregressive models, where basically the idea is that if I take a time series and I'm taking shifted versions of that time series, so what you see is each of these lines is the last time point cut off, and it's shifted a bit to the right. If I'm taking shifted copies of that time series and I somehow fit a regression model, in this case an autoregressive model, so that means that I'm estimating a set of beta parameters, a set of coefficients with which I'm going to multiply my time shifted copies of my signal in such a way that I'm getting as close as possible to my original signal. That's what an autoregressive model is doing. And if you do that, you are essentially you're building a model of the upcoming signal based on the past of the time series. And mathematically it looks like this. So what you have a summation term, which is summing over time lags. And for each of the time lags, for each of the shifted copies of the time series, you estimate a beta weight with which you're going to multiply your time shifted time series. You're going to add them together. And then you try to get as close as possible to the original time series. And that's what you always can do. This is essentially very similar to just a GLM, just a regression model. And the idea now is that, well, a single signal in our purpose for connectivity is not that interesting. So we can also do this, scale this up to more than one signal. So we can do a bivariate case in this example, where we're going to build two autoregressive models where signal X is trying to kind of be predicted by means of past values of signal X. Signal Y is going to be predicted by means of past values of signal Y. This itself is not interesting, but now we can ask ourselves the question, what is going to happen if I'm going to make slightly more complicated models? So rather than predicting signal X only based on itself, we also include the past of signal Y in the prediction, and the other way around. Yeah. So you can always do this. Yes, you can apply some mathematical operation to it, and what you end up with a model which is to some extent well or poorly fitting your data, and the extent to which it's well or poorly fitting the data is basically quantified by the noise terms here at the right. Yeah. And the idea now is that if we compare for these two sets of models the noise terms, or better said, the variance of the noise terms, which essentially quantifies kind of the residual, so the, like, how well does my model fit, and we take the ratio between them, so we take the ratio of the variance of the noise term of the simple model divided by the variance of the ratio divided by the variance of the noise term of the second model, where it's a more complicated model where we included predictions of signal Y, where we included the past of signal Y to predict signal X. If this quantity or the logarithm of it is sufficiently large, we say that actually there is information in the past of signal Y which helps us to predict signal X. So in some way, and that's what Granger has come up with, signal Y is Granger causing signal X. There is past information that is predicting signal X. And we can also do it the other way around, so we can also do it for the blue terms. And that gives us the Granger causality from signal X to Y. So this is an asymmetric interaction. So Granger causality from X to Y is different from Granger causality from Y to X, which is different from the traditional correlation type of measures. And this is very similar to I here paint kind of a slide where I show the analogy between Granger causality, autoregressive models, and plain regression, just to say that there is not so much magic involved, actually. Because when you do a simple regression and if you are comparing, for example, two models, two regression models, what you are doing is you're doing an F-test, and you're comparing kind of the residuals of two model, like one model with a slightly more complicated model, and you're asking yourself the question, does my additional included information, my additional regressor, does that explain substantially better my data compared to a simpler model? That's essentially what you are doing with Granger causality as well. Okay, so now I'm moving to the like a neat and important issue. So before I was, it was a bit technical, just explaining to you two kind of prominent types of connectivity measures in the frequency domain that people have been using recently to quantify interactions. And these are essentially indeed black box operations, right? You take two signals, you apply your black box operation, and you get a value out. But then the challenge only starts because then we have to interpret these values. You always get a value. So I mean, like, which value is more, what does this value mean? And there are quite a few challenges, which is a bit disturbing sometimes, because if you play the devil's advocate, you can always explain away a lot of the stuff you're finding. And like a few prominent ones I just point out here. So first of all, many of these connectivity measures, they are biased. And what I mean with this is that you always get a value, and this value is typically always larger than zero. But the question is, does larger than zero mean anything? And the problem is that this bias, the bias you get, is often depending on many things. And one important thing it's depending on is the sample size that you used to quantify your measure. So for example, coherence. So the fewer observations you have, the expected value of the coherence is larger the fewer samples you have in estimating it. In the extreme case, if you have only one observation, the coherence will always be one. And that's basically meaningless, because that you cannot tell then whether or not signals are interacting. So one practical consideration always to keep in mind if you are doing a estimation of connectivity in two experimental conditions is, if you find a difference, can that be due to the difference in the bias, right? The bias, so the noise doesn't average out. The fewer trials you have, the more noise, the larger the influence of the noise. So in that difference, you always have to think about that. A very other important one, and that's what's kind of already several people asked about, is that there is the problem of what is called common pickup of field spread, particularly in EEG and MEG recordings, where the idea is that electrodes, signals recorded at electrodes or signals recorded at MEG sensors, they are always reflecting a mixture of many sources, and many of which are actually the same sources picked up by these sensors. So these are sources that are coming from the brain, like the things we're actually interested in, so that's something. But like also problematically, there might be physiological sources, for example the ECG signal, like the heartbeat, that is picked up by the signals. And there is this statement that it's especially problematic when those physiological sources have internal synchronization themselves, because if that's the case, and I'm going to show that in a minute, tricks that have been proposed, such as the imaginary part of the coherency that try to account for common pickup, don't work anymore. And I'm showing that in a minute. A third type of interpretational issue is that that signal-to-noise ratio issues, so differences in signal-to-noise ratio across experimental conditions, they can also present themselves as differences in connectivity. Or differences in connectivity, differences in connectivity can be the consequence of differences in signal-to-noise ratio. So if you are very happy and you report a difference in connectivity in two experimental conditions, you always have to check whether there might have been also changes in power. And that's something you typically never can control for in your experimental setup. And why one reason why that is the case is that typically if we have a better signal-to-noise ratio, if we have larger amplitude oscillations, which we assume to be coming from the sources of interest, then the quality with which we are going to estimate the phase, the reliability with which the phase is estimated is higher. So also anything which is based on phase difference estimates is going to be much more reliably estimated. So it will be more consistent, and then you get a higher coherence, just due to the fact that you have stronger oscillations. Is this a problem? Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. Why? Well, the one thing one might ask is that, okay, if I have a situation in which in one condition there is a stronger activation of a source or two sources, and I get by consequence also a stronger estimate of the connectivity, it could very well reflect indeed the true interaction. So what happened, why does the amplitude or the activity of a source increase in the other condition? Well, it could, well, one could say, oh, that is just due to the interaction. So there's a chicken and egg story, right? Like the alternative explanation is, well, I mean, it's just trivial, these sources are just becoming more active due to some reason X, which does not have anything to do with their interaction, and that's why. And our finding of a higher interaction measure is basically a confound. I don't have a solution to that, but the thing is that, like, in the interpretation and the discussion of the results, I think it's always good to give an impression that we have thought about it, rather than just as what has often happened, people just write down, oh, we find a higher coherence, so there is more interaction. It's always good to keep the discussion going. This is quite a complicated slide. I'm going to do it in 2 minutes, and then I hope if you don't get it that you look back at it later. But this is actually reflecting the fact that what I've been saying before, that there can be very many scenarios which have to do with signal to noise, which have to do with how signals are actually mixing with one another, like signals, how sources are actually mixing with one another to give rise to the measured signals, that give rise to scenarios in which, in the end of the day, we're estimating a change in synchrony, a change in interaction, while at the same, we know that they are caused by other things. So what is shown here in each of the columns, I'm still using this, which is a bit silly. In two conditions, in two rows, I'm depicting a situation where I'm measuring connectivity between sources, and that's expressed as a part of a circle, right? Where the true sources and their interactions is pointed here at the left. So this is what we are actually interested in. And in this situation, we have some noise sources and we have some interacting sources, which are the red and the yellow one, and the black part of these circles each time reflects the extent to which they are interacting. So if I move from condition one to condition two here, what this depicts is that in condition one they are interacting a bit, and in condition two they are interacting more because 3/4 of the circle are black. Yeah. Okay. Now what is happening typically is when we're doing recording, we are not exactly measuring only in our signals source 1 and source 2, but we are picking up in our sensors or in our virtual channels in the source level, we are picking up mixtures of activity. So what's happening in our signals is that each of the signals is picking up a mixture, which is different contributions of the two sources. That's what's happening in the middle, right? So what you see here is that each of them picks up red and yellow a bit, to a different extent. It picks up the synchronized part, which is the black part, and it picks up some unique noise, which is white and gray. And then our black box operation to compute the connectivity is basically getting the common part, so what's overlapping between these two circles. So what is shown here, it's kind of the connectivity that's estimated here reflects the true interaction plus some of the unique contributions of the particular sources. If we now move to a condition where the synchrony or the interaction is increased, what you get, well, again, you get this mixing and you get your connectivity estimate. And what you see from A to B is that this is slightly larger than this. So we conclude correctly that the interaction between the sources is increased in condition two. This is what we want. This is what we ideally want to interpret. These are situations which in the end yield an increase from condition A to condition B in estimated connectivity, But the increase is actually not due to an increase in interaction. So, for example, this is the common pickup, the single underlying source that we have already talked about a bit. There's just one source, but this one source, rather than being activated at a certain level, it's activated more, so it's larger, right? It becomes larger, so kind of it has a more contribution here, so it also leads to a larger connectivity. This situation is signal to noise, where there is, in condition B, there is actually less noise, less pollution by signals of no interest, which also shifts the balance of the mixing to the connectivity measurement. And there is, well, you can come up with a million different situations. So if you don't really get it, I suggest to kind of look back at it or ask about later, because we have to move on, I think. If I just look at the time, yes, I do. Or is it a short question?
Yes, just a short question. Yep. In the second situation, does normalization help with this kind of things?
Yeah, no. So the normalization, I kept that out of the cartoon here a bit. But the normalization is included in this computation in some way. So it doesn't help. Period. Discuss it offline. So we were discussing kind of this common pickup. So this is just depicted once more. So if we have a single underlying source, it projects the activity to all the channels at once. And if you're then going to compute some correlation between these channels, then, well, you get a zero, non-zero value. And that's the same goes also if you have a physiological artifact like the heartbeat, right? The heartbeat is visible, at least in MEG, in EEG to a lesser extent, but also sometimes quite prominently at the channel level. And then we have already discussed this in some detail. Then people started up with coming up with solutions, where one solution was like imaginary part of coherency, where imaginary, it's a mathematical term. So it's not that it doesn't mean it's not there, but it's just like because they, like some mathematicians decided to call it the imaginary part. And by convention, it's kind of in a plane, it's pointing in the along the direction of the y-axis. And that has to do with the fact, since you asked, that imaginary numbers are very strange numbers, because it basically means that the number I, that's the imaginary number, I squared is minus one. And that's a very strange concept, but that's I guess that's why they called it imaginary. So don't get hung up on that. So the reason why people came up with this is kind of depicted in this cartoon, where the idea is if you have a single source which is impacting its activation on the channels instantaneously, it does so with a particular length. So like the length reflects simplistically how close this source is to a particular channel, right? So this length is slightly longer than this length. But what is important to realize is that the angle with which it's impacting on these channels is the same. Yeah, so if you do a phase difference measurement, like if you subtract the phases, then you are pointing along the x-axis, the real valued axis. So the imaginary part of the coherency estimated between two channels which are only seeing a single source is zero. No interaction, correct conclusion. If we now have two sources which are interacting, so they have a consistent relationship with respect to one another, each of these two sources, so the colors are a bit confusing, sorry about that, but like the red and the orange arrows reflect the contribution of the blue and the purple source respectively onto the individual channels. Sorry about that. They are projecting, so they are pointing in each individually in the same direction. The length is slightly different due to how far away they are from the channels. But overall, what the signals here are picking up is the green arrow, because it's the mixture between the yellow and the red. It's a summation of the yellow and the red arrow. It's a mixture of the blue and the purple source. And if you take the green arrows and you take a phase difference is non-zero. And that's what you're picking up, because if you then take the imaginary part of the coherency, which is kind of the projection onto the y-axis of this green arrow, it's different from zero. So then people say, well, there is a true interaction. The problem is, and this is what I'm going to end up with, because otherwise the coffee will be cold, And that's related to this physiological source which has internal synchronization. You can overinterpret non-zero values of imaginary coherency. And that's what I show with this very simple kind of example, where I show a very cool result. And this cool result is a topography, MEG topography, where color-coded, it's shown for each electrode or each sensor, on average, the, let's say, a proxy of the imaginary part of the coherency. So in this case, it's the weighted phase lag index, which is a very similar measure. On average, between each channel and every other channel, and from red to blue, it essentially means the interpretation of this topography means that in the alpha band, so this has been computed for the alpha band, in the alpha band there is a front to back directed influence. So the frontal part of the brain has a top-down influence on the back part of the brain. Yeah, that's what people get enthusiastic about, because like frontal areas are for cognition, back part is just for perception, so kind of frontal areas are kind of doing something which is probably relevant. And then I'm going to explain how I got this. Well, I got this by taking data, and I did an independent component analysis, and I extracted two important components, like two very prominent components from this data, which essentially reflect heartbeats. So there are heartbeat is very prominent in this data set, but they need to be described by more than one single component for some reason. Well, it's not some reason, it has to do with the fact that the cardiac electrical potential needs to be described by more than one spatial component. And the spatial topographies of these components with which they are impacting onto the MEG helmet is illustrated here. And the problem now is that these signals, they have a non-zero phase relationship with respect to one another. Yeah. Because of the fact that they are mixing onto the channel level with different topographies, that means that each of the channels in our MEG picks up a slightly different mixture of these individual heartbeat components, where each of these heartbeat components have a particular phase relationship to one another, which is different from zero. So if you now apply your black box operation that is computing your synchronization measure and then taking the imaginary part of it, because you have just learned from me that that is a good thing to do, then you're still over-interpreting your results. Although there is a true non-zero phase difference interaction between signal components, but these signal components are not the ones you want to tell your story about, right? You don't want to tell your story about that you used a very expensive machine, if it's MEG, but also with EEG, that you did a very kind of complicated analysis just to say something about the heart, because then you could have just recorded your ECG. So this is something I'm going to skip that has to do with also source reconstruction, and that we might can talk about it later or during the hands-on session. But I just want to kind of conclude now that I hope at least that I managed to convey with my, let's say, level of enthusiasm. I'm really enthusiastic about this, so just want to convey to you that connectivity analysis is cool. And there are many measures on the market which you don't have to be afraid of, but you just have to kind of know a little bit about it. And you have to know that actually in the end of the day, they are quantifying very similar things. That there are confounds in the interpretation, which particularly have to do with this common pickup and also with signal-to-noise ratio issues, which cannot easily be addressed. Well, the common pickup issue can be addressed by the recommendation that we typically say that it's not a good idea to do your connectivity analysis at the channel level, but you have to do a source reconstruction first and then do the connectivity analysis on the source reconstructed signals, with the idea that the effect of this mixing, this common pickup, is attenuated by the source reconstruction, although this adds a level of complexity to your analysis which is difficult, well, which brings its own problems, right? And particularly if we are talking EEG, source reconstruction with EEG is not trivial, so it might not be feasible to do to begin with. But the most important take-home message, I think, is that the interpretation of the results should always be done with care. And not only about the, like, and then the, my take-home message would be not only the interpretation of the results that you obtain yourself, if you're going to give it a shot, but also the interpretation of the results that other people claim to have found. So always kind of like it's healthy to take stuff with a little grain of salt, I would say. It's always healthy, but particularly in the context of connectivity. Okay, I would like to stop here. I hope that there are strobe wafels downstairs, but before we go there, no, there are no strobe wafels downstairs, only in the afternoon, I hope. Do we don't have coffee?
No, we're going to start coffee in half an hour.
Oh, okay, then I can. Are there any burning questions for now, or shall we?